architect Priyanka. Welcome to my channel. This is my first video and I have started with the first video with the Mughal masterpieces of India. Yes, you guessed it right, it is the Taj Mahal. It was commissioned by Shahjahan as a mausoleum for his wife Mumtaz Mahal along the banks of river Yamuna. It is known for its finest qualities and graceful proportions. It is a building cladded fully by marble. So in the following video, I'm going to talk about the site planning, the architecture characteristics, the design strategies, elevational features and decorations. The location of the Taj Mahal is along the bend of river Yamuna. On one side of the river Yamuna, we find the Taj Mahal. On the opposite side is the proposed Black Taj. And at the bend of river Yamuna, we find the Red Fort at Agra. And the orientation of the Taj Mahal is along the east-west, north-south directions. Perfectly aligned. Began in 1632 and ended in 1648. That means it took 16 years to complete the Taj. The inspirations for the Taj Mahal are easy to locate. The first inspiration is the Hushanshah's tomb at Mandu, the second being Humayun's tomb at Delhi, and the third is Khane Khanan's tomb at Delhi. So here in this particular slide you can see all the three inspirations, the Khane Khanan's tomb, the Hushanshah's tomb and the Humayun's tomb. If you just see, we find that the Khane Khanan's tomb very closely resembles the Taj Mahal. So here in Khane Khanan's tomb, we can find that the tomb is elevated on a plinth. The plinth consists of series of arches. Then you have the Iwan. The Iwan is the central portal arch. And above that Iwan, we can find that there is this main dome. This main dome is elevated by a drum. And on either sides of the main dome, on the four sides of the main dome, we can find that there is the dome canopies, also called as the chhatris, and here again we can find that it is actually symmetrical. The next inspiration is the Hushanshah's tomb at Mandu. In this tomb we can find that it is a cubical base. On that cubical base we can find there is a dome. That dome is elevated by a drum, and around the dome again we have the subsidiary domes, smaller domes, and the dome is topped by the finial and it is all cladded in white marble. And the next major inspiration for the Taj is the Humayun's tomb at Delhi. The Humayun's tomb forms a major inspiration for the Taj. It is the first garden tomb of India. Here we can see the architectural features. It is elevated onto a plinth with a series of arches, and again we can find that there is the Iwan, the central Iwan. There is a drum. Onto a drum we find the onion dome. That onion dome is topped by the finial, and we can find a double dome into this Humayun's tomb, and this dome is surrounded and flanked by dome chhatris on all the four sides. So this is a sandstone and a marble building. Generally, the tomb was placed in the center of the formal garden, as we can find in the Humayun's tomb as well. But in the Taj Mahal, the builders decided to place the tomb at the head of the formal garden. So this resulted into a larger foreground in the front, and this gave a very different dimension to the Taj Mahal and added a depth and a perspective effect altogether. You can see the effect of the planning in this particular picture. The plan consists of a rectangle which is along the north-south directions. It measures 579 meters by 304.8 meters with a square garden as a foreground for the tomb. At the head of the garden we can find that there is a tomb, and on either sides of the tomb we can find two subsidiary structures. The plan form is square with 56.69 meter side and its corners are chamfered. It consists of a central octagonal hall and smaller octagonal chambers which are all connected by radiating corridors. These octagonal chambers are topped by domes on each of them, with the central octagonal hall capped by the huge bulbous dome. The height of the tomb plinth is 6.7 meters. The tomb is elevated onto a terrace which is flanked by two identical structures cladded in sandstone on either sides to add to the symmetry. On the west, it is the mosque, and on the east, it is the guest house. The Taj Mahal complex is enclosed by a high crenellated sandstone wall with the site along the river Yamuna as unwalled. This high boundary wall has octagonal pavilions on each corner. As soon as you enter through the entrance gateway which frames the Taj Mahal, you are transmitted to an overall different world altogether. The entrance gateway frames the Taj as well as acts as a transition from the outside world and the Taj complex inside. The monumental entrance gateway facing the south is along the axial axis, which means the design and the plan is symmetric along this axis. It consists of 22 small domes and is cladded with red sandstone and marble. So here you can see the octagonal pavilions. Babur was the first to bring Mughal gardens in India, and we can just see the features of Mughal garden through this painting, which includes that the garden is square shaped, which is divided by channels, water channels, and it consists of colorful vegetation and a water tank. So in the Taj Mahal complex we can find the Charbagh, also referred as the four part garden, which acts as the foreground for the Taj Mahal. It is pleasing, soothing for eyes, and in harmony of the building scheme. It consists of water channels which divide the garden into four parts. The water channel consists of fountains and the central water pool reflects the Taj. The garden thus creates a microclimatic effect due to the vegetation and evaporative cooling due to fountains and water channels and pools. So here we can see the water channels. And the water channels are surrounded by the pathways on both the sides, and in the center we can find the reflecting pool, which gives a very fantastic view of the Taj into the water. And we can find the high crenellated sandstone boundary walls on all the three sides, and the side which is facing the river Yamuna as unwalled. So this is the overall plan of the Taj Mahal complex. The minaret is a three-stage, freestanding tower ending with a pavilion, and that pavilion has a dome canopy above it, and the height of the minaret is almost 41.75 meters. It is placed at the corners of the plinth, and the minarets are detached over here, and these minarets give a very different kind of a dimension for the overall Taj Mahal complex. So here we can see the three-stage minaret. The three-stage minaret is topped by a dome. That dome again has a finial, and we have three balconies. All these balconies are supported by brackets, and above the dome canopy we have the finial, and we can find the octagonal pavilion over here. The minaret consists of a tapered cylindrical shaft, and the minarets are designed that they will be tilted a little bit outwards, and the reasons are for the optical illusions, and the second reason is that even in the case of the earthquake, the minar should not collapse onto the tomb. The minarets give a 3D spatial frame for the Taj to sit in the center of the composition. So here in this picture you can just see how it would have been if there were no minarets, which prove the overall importance of the minarets in the design of the Taj. The further functions of the minarets are, they define the tomb and give a scale and allow to integrate into the surroundings, naturally creating a harmonious integration. The bulbous onion dome is supported by the drum, which is almost 7 meters high. The dome consists of a lotus motif detail at the end, and this dome ends with a finale.
The dome measures 25 meters in height and the inner dome is at 35 meters from the plinth.
So here in this particular section we can find the bulbous dome. The bulbous dome is topped by the finale and here we can find the double dome below it, and the space between the outer shell and the inner shell is too much, and you find here the chhatris on both the, on all the sides of the dome. Then you have the double height space inside and series of arches on different levels. The minarets over here you can see as seen are all detached and they are punctuated by balconies. The actual grave is well below the ground, and when you visit it you find the another prototype of the grave done in the hall, central hall. So here we can find the mini spires, also referred as the guldastas. These guldastas consist of the lotus motif detail, and they have an octagonal shaft. The Taj is guided by its proportions, which results in a harmonious composition which is related to each other. The Makarna marble is used for the cladding, which takes a subtle variations of the sky, which leads to different experience of seeing the Taj at various time of the day and weather. So here we can find that the Taj Mahal is elevated onto a plinth. That plinth consists of series of arches. The arches are false arches, and here you have the four minarets. The minarets are placed at the corner of the plinth, and the minarets are all detached. Here in the elevational features we can find that there are these tiny mini spires, which are also called as the guldastas, which you can just see over here. Then we have the chhatris. The chhatris are actually the domed canopies which are placed on either sides of the main dome, bulbous dome, and surrounded by the Iwan. We can see the Iwan. Surrounded by the Iwan on both the sides, we can find that there are two layers of arches on either sides. Then this is the drum. The drum is very well camouflaged by the Iwan. This is the central vaulted arch. And here intricate jali patterns we can find. The whole building is cladded by white marble. This is the bulbous dome. On the bulbous dome we can find the lotus motif, which is topped by the finale. The height of the Taj is almost 73 meters, that is, it is almost equal to a modern 20-storied structure, but you cannot make it due to its scale and proportions. Interior decorations in the Taj are very intelligently used in the overall scheme so that they do not overpower the forms. The decorations are finest and very proportionate are in harmony with the forms. The decorations are in the form of pita dura work, also referred as the stone inlays, stucco, marble dados and bas relief. The decorations are of different themes of calligraphy, abstract forms, vegetative motifs. Precious and semi-precious stones are used in the inlays. The jalis are finest and intricate and made out of white marble. This is actually a dado panel of the Taj, and here you can just see the inlay work. The inlay work is done by the use of precious and semi-precious stones, and it surrounds the dado panel. In this particular picture, we can find the different decorations used in the Taj. We can see the marble carvings in the Iwan area. Then we can also see the intricate marble jali in the center. Then we can also find the dado panels, these dado panels as we had discussed earlier. And we can find the floral inlay work in the spandrel area, and around the Iwan we can find the calligraphy panel. There is so much to tell about the Taj Mahal, but I guess I have covered all the major design strategies and architecture features. I hope you all like the video. See you next time.